Heather, thank you so much for having me in your really cool studio today. I can't wait to talk about all of your different work and your process, but let me start here. When did you fall in love with art or start thinking of yourself as an artist?
I fell in love with art as a child. I've always been a maker. When I was young, I had a box about this, you know, a 2x2 foot, 2x2 box that was, my mom would just put crayons and watercolor paints and things, and then she would put it up in the closet and I have to ask for it. So this tiny little box was my treasure box, but I would, I loved it, and that's what was my go-to. But when I didn't have those supplies, I would use things outside like sticks and leaves and rocks and just build little sculptures outside. So I've always been a maker. I still struggle with the word artist just because the weight that it carries. I feel like some people think an artist is like this mystical thing, and it's like, I just make stuff and I enjoy making things. So if someone calls me an artist, that's great, but I have a hard time calling myself an artist. It's just, I don't know. It's a word that carries a lot of meaning, and I don't know that I really fit what a lot of people think of as an artist.
Let's talk about your mediums. You work with several different media. What is your favorite and how did you start?
So I like to jump around. So I have done glass blowing, I've done basket weaving, I've worked with yarn, I work with beads. I just work with all kinds of things. You can see behind me, I work with plaster for a long time. So I just find something that I think is interesting and has a lot of options. And then I really like to explore one medium for a long time and like see what its potential is. And then I get tired of it and move on to something else. And when I do that, so I've learned a lot about plaster. So that allows me to still incorporate plaster if I need to. So I'm kind of always filling my toolbox with knowledge of different types of media, and then just incorporate it however I want to down the line. I used to spend a lot of time thinking, what do people in Fort Wayne want to buy? How can I make art that is sellable? Because art's changed a lot over the last couple decades in Fort Wayne. But when I was struggling with that, it was mostly landscapes and realism, and I just wasn't into that. So took a few trips to New York City and went to the galleries in Chelsea, and I just was given permission there in my mind. Like, I can do anything that I want. And there are no rules in art. So then I just started saying, I don't care what people think anymore. I'm just gonna do whatever I want.
So at that point, it really started to become an expression.
Right, that's when I gave myself total freedom to just do whatever I want. And if I wanna use glitter, I'm gonna use glitter, even though it's supposed to be this elementary school material. I'm gonna use that. And actually, I was in a gallery just a couple days ago in Minneapolis, and this artist was making cool things out of glitter. And I was like, awesome, there's glitter.
I'm onto something. So before we started shooting, you and I talked for a bit, and you were saying that a lot of your, especially early work, denotes some hard edges, and you have come to realize now that really was self-expression.
Yeah, absolutely. So I will create a piece because something comes into my head out of nowhere. I don't even know, but I can sometimes either have the concept or see the thing in my head and I just have to make it. So in that earlier work, I always had to have a hard edge. So I may start with something that was soft and cozy, and then I had to add something prickly and sharp and dark. And I never could consider something to be finished or complete unless it had that really dark undercurrent. I wasn't into pretty or neat or fluffy things, but it always had to have that undercurrent of darkness, and I never really understood why, but it never felt finished unless it had that element.
So you worked through all of that and then came to realize that you had some trauma that you hadn't dealt with, and now you are, it makes total sense.
Yeah.
Why these like pretty woven pieces then have nails.
Right. Realizing that I had lived through a significant childhood trauma was terrifying. Mm-hmm. So these memories just like came flooding back to me one day, and it was absolutely terrifying. Like, it, trauma overtakes your whole body, and it was like my physical self was remembering this moment, and it was pure terror. So the next day I called a therapist and said, hey, I know that this happened to me and now I need help. Mm-hmm. So now it's liberating, because I've spent the last year and a half working really intently and really hard to help heal those wounds that I've carried with me so long. And now that I understand what happened, I'm looking back at my work and saying, oh my gosh, that makes sense now. Why I had all these comparisons of soft to hard, and you know, loving and comforting to then something very sharp and scary. So it makes sense. So that was my subconscious self speaking to me, and it didn't make sense, but now it does.
And your work has changed over the last year and a half.
Yeah, absolutely.
Tell me about that. What does that evolution look like?
So I like to have people think about the serious things in life, but also remember that there's always wonder in life, and there's always something cool to discover, even through the hardest things that we have to deal with. Like, my trauma was horrifying, but even through that, I have learned so much about myself. Mm-hmm. And knowing that even in the darkest moments, there's always something positive to look for. And also just remembering that the world and life is full of wonder and surprises. So I like to put those things in my work. Also, playful things from childhood seem to be coming back into my work. Those things, and I spent a lot of years teaching in elementary school, so I still have a connection to that. So I'm inspired by just the sense of wonder that kids have, and try to keep bringing that into adulthood. Mm-hmm. So my plaster pieces that people stand in and put their head in, part of that is just to remember that life really isn't so serious, and you should, you know, it's fun to watch adults look like fools. Some people like look at it like, I don't get it. And that's fine. And other people that are willing to spend time with it and look at it for a long time, those are the people that spot the little quirky things that I add. And those are the people that really understand the story that I'm trying to tell. So I want to surprise them, because they may look at it and think that it's just some big wild mess. But then if you really sit and spend time with it, you see that there's a story there. And the more time that people spend, then they see that there are little hidden secrets there. So I guess it's taking time to just stop and really be in the moment and spend time with the piece. And then whatever feeling that brings out of people that doesn't matter to me. That's up to them.
What has been the biggest challenge as a maker, as you call it? Mm-hmm. What have you come up against that is the hardest for you?
Like I said, that people not understanding really abstract work, you know, it seems like in big cities it is readily accepted and even celebrated, but that's been one of the harder things in this area, is to just do things that are bold and really out of the box, and learning to accept that it's okay if not everyone understands it, and being okay with that it's something that I feel is important and that's good enough. Mm-hmm. And put it out there. And I do see that people are starting to accept abstract work. And I feel that is because some of us are putting it out there, so that people are learning, the audiences are learning, what are the deeper meanings behind abstract work, and what is the value of abstract. So it is different. We're not creating a reproduction of something that exists. When you paint a flower or a still life, you're creating something that exists. But when you're creating abstract, it's a thought and completely new. So it's completely from our minds. Other artists that make abstract work, it's like creating something brand new that doesn't exist, rather than a bowl of fruit. that is there.
Sure.
So it's not as much skill-based, even though you'd be surprised how well a lot of us can draw if we want to draw something realistic. People don't know that we have that skill oftentimes. So it's just, again, it's full of surprises.
You were telling me that these pieces are works in progress. Do you have any idea where they're going to end up? Or when you work on them, are you just really kind of letting whatever is in there come out?
Yeah, absolutely. So I do know that I want to use a lot of bright colors. I don't, I'm trying to limit myself to not use black because I used to depend so much on black and dark colors. So I want to focus on bright colors. And a little more sense of whimsy. I want to try to stay away from that darkness, and we'll just see where it goes. But yeah, bright colors, fun things, fun materials, like you see glitter, and there's some tulle on there. And well, I do like the 3D element when things are popping out, so I'll continue to do that. And
a lot of artists tell me that one of their biggest challenges comes in deciding a piece is done. Do you have that challenge, or is it pretty clear to you when you've finished something?
I have a sense of, okay, this is getting close, or this is starting to turn into something, but there is definitely that risk of going across the line, and then basically it's like a wave that you it's finished and then you ruin it, and then you have to start over. And sometimes we do, or I do, and I know when I say we, I mean other artists that have a similar style, we just obliterate it and start over. So it's kind of like they are layers on the canvas of works that are no longer seen, but they're still part of the process. So that's kind of a metaphor too, I guess, if you look at life and all of that. But yeah, you just have to kind of trust your gut and stand back and say, okay, this is finished, and then let it sit for a while and maybe come back to it in a month or two and add a little tweak or something. But it's always a challenge to know, when is this finished?
Heather, I am so glad I came here today. I love your work. I love that whether you intended to or not, it really is all full of metaphor and really, really cool and empowering. So thank you for inviting me, and continue your great work.
Yeah, thank you.
Arts in Focus on PBS Fort Wayne is funded in part by the Auer Foundation and the Community Foundation of Greater Fort Wayne.